So a very good evening to all. So happy to say that so this is the 17th weekly webinar series actually we are organizing, and this is the 17th topic, and this ranges to 17th one because for the last 16 topics were a huge success, and we are so happy to say that we got amazing responses from all over the world. And what's the reason for that is the effective participation of the participants, and the selection of the speakers was actually so good, commented by a few of the personalities, because they are giving a lot of insights to our topic. So this is continuing our journey and leading to the 17th weekly webinar series. And today we are having an amazing personality. I like to say he's a professor and head of the Department of Neurosurgery, NIMHANS, Bangalore. And he's dealing our topic on brain health, and he will give you a lot of insights on the same topic on brain health. And with so much pleasure, I like to say that such a beautiful, such a great personality we are having today. So without wasting time, I like to invite Mr. A.G. Harindralal, who is the chairman of the Inter-Society Activities, who is the person behind all these things, from arranging and scheduling of these things. And I like to, with so much insight, I like to invite Harindralal, sir. Over to you, sir, for presenting the welcome address.
Thank you, Sumo. At the outset, let me apologize to you for some technical snags. We have 350 registrations from 10 different countries. Because of some problems, the technical snags, it was limited to 100. I am very sorry for the participants, and to the speaker also. I beg your pardon, sir, for the issues, for the technical issues caused. It is my pleasure and privilege to welcome you all, the members. And Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao, head of the Unit 1 of Neurosurgery Department of NIMHANS. For coming over, permitting us to present a paper for him on his behalf. Thank you. I welcome all of you, including Prof. Bhaskar Rao, including the office bearers of the participating units. I invite Suhair, Abdul Khadar Suhair, the chairman of the BMFT, to introduce the speaker.
Good evening. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Okay. You're audible. Yeah.
Leaders of the hosting organizations and the distinguished participants. Today's talk is important from two counts. One is the topic itself. It's about the most critical, most sensitive, and most complex organ of our body, the brain. The human brain is roughly 2% of our body weight, but consumes 20% of energy intake. The brain is born with 86 billion neurons with trillions of connections, an unimaginable network performing multifarious activities. Many major diseases are associated with the brain, like amnesia, dementia, depression, epilepsy, and so on. The second importance of the talk is the speaker of the day. When I check the 10 qualities of a good doctor, it says, compassion, understanding, sympathy, honesty, competence, commitment, humanity, courage, respect, and optimism. If you want to find all these qualities in one person, you may walk into Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao, a unique, unassuming personality with suave manners and a smiling face. He was one among the handpicked professionals by Dr. M.S. Vallithan to build the Sri Chitra Medical Institute, where he pioneered setting up a epilepsy center. We all remember Dr. Mohan in the neurology, Dr. Nasser in the cardiology, and Dr. Bhaskar Rao to the growth of the institution. He has acquired highest qualifications in neurosurgery and practiced in some of the best hospitals in the world, United States, Canada, Australia, Britain, Middle East, including the Mayo Clinic in USA. he couldn't resist the call of the public sector in motherland to serve the public at large. So leaving the lucrative job, he returned to NIMHANS, Bangalore, where he is now working as a professor and also the head of the unit. We are very fortunate to have him today to speak on this very important topic. A lot of people have registered expecting to hear from him. But we, as Harindralal said, some technical snags is preventing from a large crowd attending the program. Anyhow, we will be circulating the recordings of the proceedings. Over to you, Dr. Bhaskar, for your illuminating talk. Thank you very much.
So, so thank you, Suhail, sir, for this wonderful introduction. And now I'd like to invite Dr. M. Bhaskar Rao, who is the speaker of this session today. I'd like to thank you, sir. So please join. The mic is with you, sir, please. And dear participants, please ensure that you have muted your audio and video, and we can have an interactive session to the last 10 minutes of this session. So please, if you need technical issues, you may please contact us. Thank you, and over to you, sir, please.
Respected chairman, panelists, and participants in this webinar, good evening. First of all, I am thankful to the leadership of the inter-society webinar series, especially Harindralal sir and Mr. Suhair of PMFT, for the opportunity given as well as for the kind introduction. 2 years ago, there were floods in Kerala. Now we are going through the COVID pandemic. We don't know what is in store for us in the future. If we are healthy and strong, we can face any adversity. I hope this presentation will help you in improving health and overall well-being. I'm not sure how many of you have seen brain surgery. This is what I do on a regular basis. What I've been doing for several decades.
Yes.
This is brain surgery. Patient is on the table, head is open here, and the tumor is being removed. See, this is the microscope which will illuminate the field and also magnify. And this is the navigation, just like how you are using GPS in a car. You use navigation to reach each and every corner of the brain. See, the surgery is being done safely and effectively, largely due to the technological support. So I take this opportunity to express my gratitude to all the engineers who have made substantial contribution to the medical technology. Now, let me start with a number of disclosures. One is, my area of expertise is in the field of neurosurgery, taking care of people with diseases and training young doctors in the field of neurosurgery. But today's topic is on health promotion and disease prevention, which is clearly beyond my comfort zone. Some of the points which I'm going to mention here, some of you may have a different opinion, they're debatable. Of course, my presentation is based on evidence, which you can verify with Google or any other source. And I'll be happy to clarify if there are any issues through email subsequently. And some of the images and videos I have used are for representative purpose only. And I have no commercial or financial interest or disclosures in this presentation. So this is how I have organized the presentation. I will start with a bird's eye view of the health and healthcare, and give you some idea about the brain structure, function, and then how nervous system is evolved, and then introduce some concepts like neurogenesis, and then mention about the factors which will affect the brain health positively and negatively, leading to brain illness as well as illness, wellness, and then finally leave you with a few take-home messages. Okay, now health has been defined as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely absence of disease or infirmity by the World Health Organization. See, one has to attain and maintain this status throughout life. My health is dependent on number of factors: me, my family, my workplace, my community, healthcare providers, and society at large. Also, please don't consider health problems as discrete events in time. We have to look at health problems in continuum and accumulation. See, atherosclerosis, which causes strokes and heart attacks in elderly people, actually the atherosclerosis starts in the childhood. So it is not that the problems start only in advanced days and then later only we have to take care. Coming to healthcare provision, there is no ideal healthcare system in the world. If there is a one such system, it will have the universal healthcare values of United Kingdom, the best of primary care of Israel, the community service of Brazil, the mental health care of Australia, health promotion of Scandinavia, and community empowerment of Africa, and the research and development of United States, and the innovation, flair, and speed of things which happen in India, and the information communications technology in Singapore, and the options, several options available. People can choose the options in countries like France, and the funding of Switzerland, and the aged care of Japan. You know, largest number of people over and above 100 year old are living in Japan. If all these combinations are there together, then that is the most ideal healthcare system, which is we lack. Now, regarding brain structure and function, Greek physician Hippocrates highlighted and mentioned the importance of brain 2,400 years ago. All our happiness, sadness, laughing, crying, shouting, getting angry, getting happy, all things come from the brain alone, and this which has mentioned before, centuries before Christ, and then he mentioned that the brain is the most powerful organ in human body and the seat of consciousness. Now, to take you through the brain structure. Brain is divided into several components, each one with a specific and important function. at birth, newborn babies brain will weigh about a pound, and then children it becomes about 2 pounds, and adults about close to 3 pounds. And brain has got gray matter on the surface, cortex, and white matter inside. And brain has got neurons, the functioning cell, as well as glial cell, which are the supporting cells. Now, Mr. Suhair mentioned for this point that brain, actually it's only 2% of body weight, but it consumes 20% of our energy. And this 80% of this energy consumption happens to produce the biological batteries, which are the power source of the amplifiers for the electrical signals along the axon. So everything happens in the brain by electrical and chemical means. So energy is utilized for this to provide the power source for the conduction and communication. So it's a soft jello-like material made up of with small organic molecules, proteins, lipids, carbohydrates, few trace elements, and quite a bit of lot of salty water. See, there are 86 billion neurons, and each neuron is connected to several thousand other neurons, producing a machine with 100 trillion connections. And the capacity of the brain is 2.5 million gigabytes of digital memory for storage of information. If you remove just one millimeter of the brain cortex and then spread the strands, 1 millimeter, this strand will be of a length of 5 kilometers, 1 millimeter of the brain, 1 cubic millimeter. Okay. And if you remove all the strands in the brain and then put them along a line, and it will be twice the length of the earth encircling the earth. That is the way it is organized. You can see there are extensive folds are there in the brain, largely to accommodate inside the skull. If you flatten all these folds and then make iron it out, then the brain surface of us is 1.6 meters, square meters. So you can see the way brain is folded and then got organized in the head. This is the center of the head, and there is a sort of hierarchical pattern. This is forebrain, this is midbrain, and this is hindbrain. The midbrain and hindbrain together are known as brainstem. So brainstem has got very essential functions like control of the respiration, control of the heart, and then coordinating the bodily movements. Whereas the forebrain is the executive center. All the information is received from all over the body to the forebrain, and based on the information received as well as based on the experience, the forebrain formulates the commands, decisions, and the judgments. And this is how brain is organized. Every brain has got a discrete structure and function. Wilder Penfield starting from 1930s, largely based on his neurosurgical procedures on people with epilepsy, where people were awake, used to electrically stimulate each and every part and identify the function. Based on that, he came with this sort of homunculus pattern, where leg control is here, hand control is here, face control is here, tongue, and then on the left side, the speech control is here. If you look from the brain point of view, this is how we look, the homunculus pattern. Now, let us spend few minutes about how things evolved over a period of time. I understand that the Earth was formed 4.5 billion years ago, and it took about close to 1 billion years for it to cool down. And soon after that, life started initially with the cells without nucleus, and then it took another 1 billion years for the cells to form with nuclei, and another 1 billion years for the multicellular life to form, and another 1 billion years to all the subsequent life forms, including humans. So this is the comparative anatomy, and each species did not start the brain structure from the scratch. So it evolved by modifying each species as the evolution progressed. Each species evolved by modifying and incorporating mechanisms of pre-existing species. And I'll be talking about neurogenesis a little later, but animals, especially rodents and reptiles with a shorter lifespan, are prone to a lot of risks in life, and then so they had persistent, frequent neurogenesis, whereas in highly evolved mammalian species, including humans, those risk factors were very much limited. So the neurogenesis has come down as species became more evolved and then more stable. So all these things happened over the human brain evolution, which I have mentioned, took thousands of millions of years to complete. So what we are now today is it's because of 86 billion neurons with 100 trillion connections structured over billions of years of evolution, and all the human years of development and learning resulted in what we are and where we are now. Now, let me introduce a very important concept called neurogenesis. We have a human body has got 37.2 trillion cells, and some cells keep regenerating on a regular basis. We all know that we donate blood on a regular basis, and if you lose skin, new skin will form, and then sometimes this thing happen even not only skin, even the intestinal cells also, lining cells also will form, new cells will form on a regular basis. But these things will not happen in the brain and spinal cord. About more than 100 years ago, this Spanish histopathologist, Santiago Cajal, who won a Nobel Prize in the year 1906, more than 100 years ago, mentioned that once brain and spinal cord growth is completed, there will be no further formation of new cells. And he said, it is for the science of future to change if this harsh decree is possible. And this his view is prevailed for several decades subsequently. Of course, fortunately, science has made progress. Now there are several advances are at disposal, like immunohistochemistry, confocal microscopy, and then stereological evaluation, and also progress made in animal research. In 1960s, Joseph Alteman identified and reported that in rodent rat hippocampus, even after postnatal, after birth, new neurons are formed. But at that time, it was thought to be a view of a lunatic. And subsequently, this Fernando, professor at Rockefeller University at New York, because of his pioneering research on songbirds, these birds, when they learn sounds and then new neurons are formed in their brain. With learning and neurogenesis, there is a strong correlation has been established by electron microscopic studies of this avian brains. And finally, in this Swedish neurologist documented neurogenesis, formation of new cells in human brain. People who were dying with terminal cancer volunteered to subject their brains to study neurogenesis after their death, and then that's how Erickson documented neurogenesis in these people who volunteered. Now, the importance of neurogenesis lies in the fact that our brains are ever-changing structures that are constantly developing and refining the structure in response to functional demands. And the human organism is built from 30,000 genes. You see, smell is still one of the important faculties we have. We can distinguish 10,000 smells, and we have 10 million neurons in the back of our nose, and 2% of our genome is used for just one modality of smell, and then neurogenesis is highest in this area. There's another important concept called neuroplasticity. So plasticity represents the observation that brain alters its structure depending upon its activity. Plasticity is how form follows function in the brain. Plasticity is a finite resource, but there are ways and means to increase and maintain the reserve of the plasticity. This flexibility in intellectuality, emotional and physical aspects, and being resilient makes a person more effective in using cognitive resources in adverse circumstances. Like the saying that to roll with the punches and rebound from adversity, it depends upon having more than one coping strategy available. Now, another important concept is resilience. Most of your engineers, and then you know about the resilience. This the dictionary defines resilience as ability to return to original shape after being stretched, pressed, bent, and so on, as well as recovering from and adjusting well to the misfortune or change. In psychology, the concept of resilience refers to the ability of most people, when exposed even to extraordinary levels of stress and trauma, to maintain normal psychological and physical functioning and avoid serious mental illness. A person who is resilient could be defined as having variety of neurocognitive tools and networks that can be activated in the context of internal and external environmental and psychological challenges, and being able to adaptively use these tools and networks to optimize function in response to an environmental and psychological challenge. Now, the where this neurogenesis happens in human brain is in a part called limbic system. You see this, these two structures called as amygdala here and then hippocampus, these are the two structures which are part of the limbic system. Amygdala is concerned with human emotions, and hippocampus is concerned with memory. See, every day we encounter new experiences in life, and then all those new experiences have to be encoded and retrieved in the brain. And hippocampus forms a very major role in encoding this information. And it's a gateway to the memory. And all the knowledge of facts, events, declarative memory goes through hippocampus. In contrast to hippocampal function, there is an implicit memory by cerebellum and rest of the forebrain, where the, for example, driving initially, we are very careful, and subsequently we drive without much focus on all the conditions, because we got a memory of how to drive in the implicit memory. So this is the importance of hippocampus, and learning increases neurogenesis in the hippocampus. Learning increases neurogenesis, and neurogenesis increases learning. There's a reciprocal relationship with the hippocampus and learning. This is an interesting study done among the taxi drivers in London. You know, to pass a driving license in London, the taxi drivers have to remember many lanes and by lanes, and those who have been memorizing the routes and the names of the routes, they had a larger hippocampus compared to people who are not used to such an exercise. Not only taxi drivers, jugglers have changes in their brain. Even medical students who prepared for the exams, who underwent brain imaging studies, showed that certain association cortices, the volume increases because of the rigorous training and exercise they go through. So both the smell as well as memory in the hippocampus is in the limbic system in the hippocampus. Now there are a couple of interesting hypotheses. One is cognitive reserve hypothesis, and second one is neurogenic hypothesis. People, especially in their childhood, with good education and physical activity and occasional training, linguistic ability, musical ability, musical training, will have a cognitive reserve, and this cognitive reserve will reduce the risk of developing health problems, especially losing memory, like in dementia and Alzheimer's disease. Not only in this later events, even otherwise also in people who sustain head injuries and who had brain infections, those with cognitive reserve will recover much better, because they have like a neurogenic reserve. Because of the intense effort from early childhood, they have abundant neurogenic reserve. New cells are formed and then remained dormant in their brains, which are used subsequently when the call comes. To illustrate the point, let me present the story of this young man who came from Kerala to Nimans. He's a budding musician practicing music from his childhood. Unfortunately, he had epilepsy from his childhood. And you see, this is the normal hippocampus on left side. And this side, the hippocampus became small. And the electrophysiological focus was found to be corresponding to this damaged right hippocampus. So being a musician, he underwent functional imaging studies when he listens to music, what happens to his brain. And then even he underwent surgery while he was listening to music, and with both electrical stimulation as well as by clinical monitoring, by listening and then identifying various aspects of music during surgery, he underwent a resection of that damaged part. And then resting state fMRI showed reorganization of his brain network. And then he did not lose any of his musical abilities due to brain surgery. You can see this is he's about to complete his graduation and then pursue a career music in the near future. Now, there are several factors which will help the brain health in both positive and negative way. For example, the head injuries and genetic predisposition and age-related changes like this diseases like dementia and Alzheimer's in elderly people, and obesity, diabetes, and sleep-related problems, depression, alcoholism, all these things will lead to reduction of the size of the hippocampus. The reserve happens with physical exercise, cognitive stimulation, music, meditation, and certain dietary factors. So it is not a linear relationship of one with the other, but it's a dynamic polygonal hypothesis where multiple factors, both positive and negative, affect the brain health. Let me take you through some of these factors. For example, pregnant women, when they eat junk food and then develop obesity as well as metabolic diseases, as well as having depression, stress, and anxiety, when they deliver the babies, the babies will have this anxiety, aggression, and then learning issues because of all the maternal factors. Even children and adolescents, those who are addicted to gadgets and then video games and then lose their sleep and then watch TV whole night and then lose the sleep. You see, later as they grow, they develop so many issues regarding substance abuse. Not only pregnant women and children with sleep disorders, even like brain networks gets affected even by day-to-day things we do. For example, here you see the network brain, how the brain network is working when people are fasting and then not even taking coffee, and 2 days later when they had food and then they had coffee, the networks, there is a change in the way brain networks function. And these brain networks, they keep changing with age. This is the network in young adults and then middle-aged people, and then how the brain networks keep changing. This is in elderly people. Now, there are few factors which will adversely affect health. One is, for example, loneliness or perceived social isolation. Now, I can feel that I am just speaking to the computer screen and feel lonely now, right now. Or alternatively, I can connect with all of you who are there. And then if I have a sense of feeling that my presentation is helping you and it will help you in improving your health condition, that's like an enriched environment for me. And see, one can feel lonely in a crowd, or one can feel enriched environment when they're connected to all people surrounding them. So it's a very major problem. You see, the risk of dying because of loneliness is actually higher than drinking alcohol and having obesity, or even more than air pollution. Now, another factor which affects brain health is poverty. Poverty is defined as an income to needs ratio of less than one. 30% of mental illness is attributed to childhood adversities. Of course, it's a modifiable factor. It's a major issue. It needs a collective responsibility of the society to improve them. Maybe people who are in powerful and influential positions can think of doing all these interventions, like, for example, modest income transfer to families living with housing and nutritional instability would likely to have a positive effect on brain health as well as physical health of children of those families. Similarly, stress experienced as a challenge at a lower level has got a positive effect. At a higher level, has got a negative effect. Fear is something, it's a very rapid response when we see something frightening, whereas anxiety is a sustained fear. Now, this stress occurs whenever there is an endogenous or exogenous challenge is perceived as unpleasant, aversive, threatening for the homeostasis of survival of an individual. And so the first response of a stress is a release of these hormones, epinephrine and norepinephrine, from the adrenal medulla. They will increase our blood pressure and then metabolic rate and then respiration very quickly, so that either we can fight or we can run away from a threatening situation. Whereas a chronic stress is different. Chronic stress has got changes because of the glucocorticoid hormones which come from adrenal cortex. The acute comes from the medulla, the chronic comes from the cortex. And these glucocorticoid receptors, they're located heavily in human hippocampus. And that's how hippocampus is vulnerable to stress. So chronic stress will decrease the hippocampal neurogenesis, leading to functional impairment, including hippocampal memory impairment. Now, coming to the addictions, alcohol addictions, alcohol addiction will cause acute inhibition of hippocampal neurogenesis, and there is evidence that during abstinence, when people do not drink alcohol, there is a recovery of function of hippocampus due to recovery of the neurogenesis, and this is documented in animal experiments as well as human studies. For example, the binge drinking for a short period reduces the cell proliferation and survival in the human hippocampus. Whereas if those people, if they do alcoholics, if they do physical exercise, some of these changes are reversed to some degree. And those who are used to alcohol for extended periods of time showed a persistent decrease of this neurons in the dentate gyrus of the rats. Whereas even stopping alcohol for a short period, there is a rebound cell proliferation in these rats which were studied. And pregnant women, when they consume alcohol, and alcohol affects the fetus also, and fetal disorders can vary from attention deficit to hyperactivity and learning and mood disorders. So there is abundant evidence that hippocampal neurogenesis and hippocampal dependent learning and memory is affected by the alcohol. And similarly, both cannabis and nicotine in the smoke, initially in small quantities, people feel enhancement of learning abilities, and also people who take drugs to enhance their memory, most of it is due to nicotine, and nicotine is the active ingredient in tobacco. So when they feel better with improvement in learning and memory, they keep on taking, and then used to these substance abuse, and later get addicted. This is a study done in Australia. You see the processing speed of the brain, the cognitive abilities are at all age groups are distinctly better in non-smokers compared to smokers across the lifespan in this Australian study. Now, the factors which will improve the brain health positively. Let me spend few minutes on these things. Exercise, physical exercise is beneficial to the brain health. Of course, the duration, the intensity, the type of physical exercise across different age groups, it is not very clear, but exercise helps. In animal experiments, these rats, even 7 days of running led to increase in the hippocampal neurons and also neuronal functional integration. This is how the animal experiments are performed. All these rats which are subjected to exercise, irrespective of the type of exercise and then the resistance level, when they do exercise, their memory, especially spatial memory, and some of the factors in their blood called brain derived natri uretic factor. This is a feel good hormone. So this feel good hormone and their spatial memory improved in animals which are doing exercise compared to rats which were not doing exercise. Now the voluntary production of this insulin like growth factor as well as vascular endothelial growth factor, all these factors will enhance the neurogenesis. Now animals are again subjected to different exercise regimes, like there are some animals did not run, and some animals run at regular time, some animals run at regular speed, different duration, and irregularly. All sorts of experiments were done. You see, this is a forced treadmill running, whereas these rats are forced to run. In the previous video, you have seen voluntary wheel running, and these rats forced to run on the treadmill. And irrespective of the type of exercise, the animals showed improvement in their neurogenesis. Of course, those who ran on a regular basis with fixed speed and duration on a regular basis, they had maximum benefit compared to those with irregular exercises and then non-runners. Like walking has got a significant health benefits. This, when we walk, the regular repetitive movements will induce theta rhythm. You know, brain works by electrical and chemical means conductance. So these are known as theta waves. These theta waves are produced in the brain during regular walking. And these theta waves cause this sort of long-term potentiation. This is the underlying correlate of learning. So people who practice regular walking have got improved chance of learning. Of course, as we become older, the neurogenesis will come down, but longer periods of exercise may be required to enhance neurogenesis in aged brains. But even with the people with dementia and Alzheimer's disease, when they pursue the walking, they still can have hippocampal neurogenesis. You see here, elderly people, seniors, who walk at least 30 minute per session daily on a regular basis for 1 year, have proven to be have greatest cognitive benefits in this study reported by Erickson. Now, a few points regarding diet and nutrition. Two important factors are there. One is calorie restriction, and second one is intermittent fasting. When we reduce the calories we take, as well as extend the interval between the meal by intermittent fasting, both have got significant health benefits, because they enhance hippocampal neurogenesis. Of course, there are some specific food items are there known as polyphenols. For example, these blueberries are known to cause cause hippocampal neurogenesis and improvement in the cognitive abilities. Same way, this resveratrol. This is found in the skin of the red grapes. This also is beneficial, has got a neuroprotective effect, and some of the claims of red wine come from this chemical component from the skin of the red grapes. And you all know that for thousands of years, this turmeric is used in Indian dietary preparations. Turmeric has got multiple benefits like antibiotic, anti-inflammatory, and neuroprotective role. And then it is the curcumin is the active ingredient of the turmeric, and then it has got 12 week intervention with curcumin increased adult hippocampal neurogenesis. Similarly, fish consumption decreased the risk of depression and suicidal tendencies, and people who consume fish on a regular basis reported better mental health issues over a period of time. Even now, women following delivery, the postpartum depression also is supposed to have decreased following regular fish consumption. So two things are beneficial. One is calorie restriction. Suppose if we reduce our food intake by 30% over a period of 3 months, you can make out 20% improvement in our cognitive abilities. And same way, intermittent fasting. Intermittent fasting has been undertaken by almost all religious faiths for centuries. And fasting helps in many things, including like irritable bowel syndrome and improved energy in people with depression and anxiety levels. All these people, when we fast and when we reduce our food intake, a lot of strategies happen in the brain how to cope with situations like that, including hippocampal neurogenesis. That's how our cognitive abilities improve. Music. We know that music influences all of us from fetal stage to adulthood. The exact mechanism at cellular level is unknown, but music is known to facilitate neurogenesis. Regeneration and repair of brain occurs through secretion of steroid hormones while listening to music. And music may affect genes and proteins, and it's equal to hormonal replacement therapy. Some of you may be taking. Now, there are innumerable number of studies suggesting that meditation, regular long duration meditation, is showed significantly increased brain volume, brain size, compared to people who do not practice meditation. Now, sleep is a very dynamic process, and we should find ways and means to find interventions more effective, especially, for example, teaching the importance of sleep hygiene to our children, and let them take proper sleep in the night, avoiding late night movies and video games, even studying the whole night should not be done, and then sleep hygiene has to be encouraged, and even the school administrators can think about adjusting the school timings and letting adolescents sleep for an hour extra in the morning, and then see how it affects their overall educational performance. Now, this is an Australian study. With all these interventions, if people who do not do all these exercise and diet control, and then do not practice music, meditation, no cognitive stimulation, they will have this sort of decline, cognitive decline with age. Whereas those who practice all these interventions, their cognitive skills, abilities, brain sharpness has retained even till in late old age also. Again, this is another recent study from the United States called Brain Fitness Program. And people who practice this 12-week brain fitness program, and they had increase in the size of the hippocampus in number of elderly people who undergone this study in United States. So these are all the factors in summary. So education, walking, and leisurely activity, even mild, small quantities of alcohol, challenging occupations, eating fish, eating fruits and vegetables have got a better cognitive outcome. Genetic predisposition, strokes, hypertension, obesity, depression, diabetes, and high alcohol use and disturbed sleep, cholesterol, all these factors, smoking, all these factors have got a negative influence on the brain. Now, I'll leave you with a few take-home messages. So our brain grows, learns, adopts, and heals. Okay. Brain disease, as with many body diseases, they're not discrete events. It's not that somebody enjoyed good health for 60 years and suddenly developed a stroke. So it's a continuum and accumulation of all the factors even before the stroke or heart attack happened. And brain, our brain health and survival depends not only, not just on our might, but on our collective abilities and this. So families, friends, colleagues, communities, societies will help each other. And the physical activity will reduce anxiety, depression, and then reduces the risk of dementia, and then improves the sleep quality. And each person's brain is unique, and there's a diversity. There's no single way, single trick to achieve brain health. People who learn to have multiple coping and learning strategies, they will develop resilience and then withstand the adversities. Some people have greater opportunity to live a purposeful, goal-striving life and tend to rate that dimension, purpose of life, as the most important for their well-being. Whereas people who lack those kinds of opportunities may rate merely enjoying the pleasures of daily social interactions as being the most important dimension. The final message is that your brain, use it or lose it. So anyone wants to seeking to improve the memory and recall ability is to continue to learn. You learn new language, you learn dancing, you learn new computer program, you learn some new sport, whatever, new cooking, whatever you want. Keep on learning new things throughout life, because brain is plastic plasticity and responsive machine. Okay, while learning new memories, new proteins are formed, new synaptic connections are formed, and literally brain grows in response to information storage and then new demands imposed by learning. Of course, as we become older, we lose muscle power and we lose brain power also, but our physical exercise improves dramatically, improves the physical condition of not only young people, but elderly people. Not only physical exercise, even mental exercise also. This is my final slide. You can do this small exercise at your home, at your convenience. We have four domains in our lives. First is our own life. Second is our life with our families and societies. Third is our professional life, in whichever walks of life you are involved. And fourth one is spiritual life. You see how much time you're dedicating or giving or using for each domain. And then, for example, mine is like this. And in fact, most of the neurosurgeons, doctors, and even maybe most of the engineers and people from other walks of life, we spend a lot of time with our work, with our profession, and very little with our families, and then less with spiritual activities and physical. You draw for yourself and then see whether is it like a perfect square shape like this, or is it distorted like that. Of course, ultimately you have to achieve equanimity, is to have equal importance in our life to both personal, family, physical, and professional life. And spirituality is an ingredient of each and everyone. And I thank you for your kind attention and the opportunity. Thank you very much.
Very, very thank you to Bhaskar sir. So it was so insightful, and we got a lot of information from you, sir. And yeah, thanks a lot, sir. From the real world examples, you have showed me what is actually. And finally, you concluded like what we want to concern, and we want to take care about our daily life like that, sir. So shall we take some few questions, sir? Shall
sure,
we?
Sure. Okay. I'll, as I mentioned in the beginning, I'm a surgeon. This is not area of my expertise. I will try my level best to clarify some of the points I mentioned in the presentation, but all questions I'll answer by email to participants who have raised these issues. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Dear participants, you can please raise your questions in Q&A, and I will pass one by one to you, sir. So my first question, somebody is asking that, I know a few cases of people above 60 years who got brain seizure from 30 to 45 minutes. After getting admitted to hospital and medication by a neurophysician, they got cured. The interesting fact is that all of them didn't remember what happened to them during seizure. I want to know that what are the reasons for getting this temporary non-function of the brain and got normalcy in short duration? And can this brain seizure repeat again?
So at home or at workplace, normally we notice so many things. We talk to people, we look at things, and suppose suddenly if there's a snake or if there's a fire, we just run from that place to protect our life. While running or escaping that place, we don't greet people, we don't ask, we don't notice things, we don't ask anybody, we don't interact with them. Because our purpose is to save life. Something similar happens during seizure. The brain mechanism during convulsion shifts from observing, learning, noticing things to saving life. Heart has to beat properly during seizure. Breathing has to be proper. Life has to sustain. So in order to sustain life, all attention is diverted towards that purpose, that goal. So we don't notice anything which happens. That is one thing. Second thing, one of the most common areas of the brain to generate seizures is hippocampus. Hippocampus function is memory, recording, retrieving memory. So during hippocampus itself is generating seizures. So while it is generating seizures, it is not doing the other function of encoding memory. So there are two ways people don't remember. They prolong the seizure, the prolonged can be impairment. Suppose if seizure happens for a small few seconds, if it happens in area which is away from hippocampus, say for example in the front of the head or back of the head or top of the head, only small area, then people will remember, people, because hippocampus is working that time. Hippocampus is not affected by the disease. So that's how some people with epilepsy remember when small area of the brain is involved in epilepsy, short duration of epilepsy, and where hippocampus is not working, that too on the dominant side, hippocampus is not affected on the dominant side. People remember things. Not only epilepsy, even we observe this in head injuries. After a traffic accident, if accident is of significant nature, person will forget many things. They will not remember how accident happened. That is because during that time, after the accident, all the body mechanism, brain, heart, lungs, all effort is to save the life inside, once all the inside mechanisms. So they will not record, register who is coming, who is talking, what they're talking and all those things, unless it is a very minor injury. And anyway, thanks for asking that question. I hope I have given the information.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Another question. Why resilience varies from person to person, and which factor in your brain helps in improving the resilience of a person when dealing with these adverse situations?
Can you please say it again? Resilience.
Yeah, sir. Why resilience varies from person to person?
No. What is the word you are using?
Resilience. R-E-S-I-L-I-N-C-E.
Resilience.
Yes. Why it varies from person to person, and which factor in your brain helps in improving the resilience of a person when dealing with adverse situations?
It's a topic on many people can do PhDs. It's a combination of factors. Genetic predisposition plays a major role. I can list innumerable number of things like health of the mother during pregnancy, and then the health of the newborn baby, and then upbringing, childhood, education, and all the social support. So unfortunately, street children are vulnerable to many societal influences. Turn out to be mostly because they do not have any coping mechanisms, will become anti-social elements, because they have no coping mechanisms when there is a hunger, what to do when there is a threat, what to do. They have no coping mechanisms. In the other way, people who are in enriched environments, I'm not talking about financial wealth alone, loving, caring families, and a lot of support from friends and colleagues and all those things. They're all enriched environments. They have with positive attitudes, and those who practice all things which I have listed earlier, their brains can withstand. If they have a problem, they can share with their families and friends, and then get some solutions. Whereas unfortunately, those who do not have these coping mechanisms, they unfortunately succumb to the pressures. So that's how resilience can be improved. Even some of you can verify the things which I mentioned about exercise, diet, music, meditation for about a year, and then see how you are able to cope with stressful situations now and 1 year later. You maintain a diary, and then you prove it by your own personal experiences. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. And there is another question. Evolution of mankind and our brain was through an evolutionary process ranging to millions of years. And what is the role of spirituality in this development of brain?
Consciousness is a very vital and important attribute. Apparently residing in only highly evolved life species like human beings. You see, the earlier mammalian species have got only two biological prerequisites. One is to survive, and second one is to procreate. You see, all life forms, from rats to rodents to monkeys to cats to dogs to monkeys to even all life forms, first they have to survive. So they have to get food, they have to eat, they have to sleep, and then they have to procreate. They have to the offspring has to continue. So they are the only biological purpose of their existence. So only with the enormous increase in the forebrain, human brain is forebrain of humans is almost four times more than chimpanzee brain. Chimpanzee is the nearest relative of humans. Compared to chimpanzee, human brain is four times more. And this four times is in the forebrain, not much in the midbrain and hindbrain. So the enormous increase in the size gave cognitive abilities and consciousness. So spirituality is a further evolution of the consciousness. So I think probably spiritual leaders may be able to give different or better explanations. But from the biological point of view, what I think is that enormous increase in the size, especially in the forebrain, where we have executive powers based on all the sensory input and learning experiences, we make decisions, and then we have a free will. So all these things collectively put together gave us the spirituality. I'll take this important question and then study further and respond to the person, participant who have asked in more details through email. Thank you.
Yeah, very thank you, sir. And there is another question, sir. Panic attacks are triggered by which part of the brain, and how the intensity or frequency can be limited?
Yeah, in the limbic system is involved with human emotions. See, the different parts of the brain do different things. For example, there is an occipital cortex. Occipital cortex function is to record visual images and then understand what we are seeing. Like that limbic system is concerned with the emotional brain. One very important part of the limbic system is known as amygdala. Amygdala is very close to the hippocampus. Actually, in one of the images of hippocampus, I showed amygdala. So amygdala is concerned with intense emotional experiences, including fear and panic. For example, every day we go from home to workplace. On the way, we see so many vehicles, so many people, so many things we see. And after we go to office, we saw all things. But after 2-3 days, we don't remember any of those things. But suppose while crossing a junction, if you see a snake, or if you see a tiger, or if there's an accident, every time you go through that road, even if there's no snake, even if there's no tiger, even if there's no accident, you still get a fear feeling. Because the event, when you saw snake or tiger or accident, is recorded. Amygdala recorded that event and told hippocampus. Amygdala conveys the information to hippocampus. Look, see, our biological purpose is we have to survive. We have to survive and procreate. So the biological purpose is survive. So amygdala will convey the message to hippocampus. There is a snake. There is a risk to life. There is a tiger. There is a risk to life. Accidents happen here. So be careful. So because of influence of amygdala on the hippocampus records that event, episodic event. And then that is the one, incidents like this from early childhood, lifelong experiences can lead to whenever people remember, recollect these events intentionally or unintentionally, they get into this panic attacks. Of course, big help is provided by the neuropsychology counseling. One has to unravel the factors which led to this sort of old memories, childhood, lifetime memories, and then explain in a rational way that, look, that is happened at one time. It is not going to happen again. So it's not going to happen again. So nothing to worry about it. So that sort of assurance and counseling will help in a much better way than taking some pills. And again, this is a very important point. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So there is another interesting question. How is that our brain almost always have a tendency to get addicted to the wrongdoings such as alcohol consumption and drug addiction, especially in the young states? And why, how does that happen?
It is not correct to say that our brain has got a tendency to get used to wrong things. We go through all sorts of experiences in life. This so-called experiences, like for example, smoking. Smoking slightly improves memory in the beginning. Alcohol slightly, it's a mood elevator, and we get so much of pleasure in using gadgets. Cell phone is the most friendly thing nowadays to all people. So that initial kick or initial feel good effect will make people drawn towards these substances, and then over a period of time they get used to it, and then at some time later dependency develops, and then it's a cumulative effect. Suppose somebody starts smoking and then drinks alcohol, he will not be able to, he or she will not be able to focus on studies, and then there's a negative feedback from school. Families are not happy, so there's a negative feedback from the families. So this negative feedback will make people to go more and more towards these addictive substances, because they find some sort of solace, some sort of recuse, some sort of comfort in when everybody is criticizing and commenting and then shouting and fighting. They find a safe haven in these things, and eventually, of course, they destroy their lives, unfortunately. But if we have to, we have to recognize, and then we have to take care of them. And the earlier we recognize, and then earlier we identify these risk factors and then take care, the better. I have mentioned about taking care of pregnant women. If we take care of pregnant women, they will have healthy babies. If pregnant woman drinks alcohol and then smokes, baby will have problem. And after delivery, also the mother will not be in a position to take good care of the child because of, so these are all cumulative and multiple factors. So one has to analyze carefully and then slowly withdraw, slowly move towards so-called better things in life. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So next I can combine questions from two participants. One is that, sir, how our sleeping time can be analyzed so that by adjusting the sleep cycles, can we refresh our brain properly? And can the intake of these fruits, and will it enhance our brain?
Two questions. One is regarding sleep. Second one is regarding the diet.
Yeah,
now,
yes.
Now, there is no one standard guideline for people that you sleep 6 hours, you sleep from 12 o'clock in the night to 6 o'clock in the morning. There is no such rule or guideline. A person should be able to sleep, get adequate sleep. How do we know what is adequate? So morning, when a person wakes up from sleep, if person feels fresh, energetic, no hangover, no problem, that means the sleep was adequate, sleep was good. So there are many things are there. People can go late into sleep, or people can get up early in the morning, and or people can have disturbed sleep, and people who have obstructive sleep apnea, that means during sleep they will have actual breathing difficulty, the gap between two breaths will become prolonged, and for a few seconds there will be no breathing. So this is known as obstructive sleep apnea. So during they wake up in the middle of the night because of all these problems. Of course, snoring is a cause, one of the manifestation of obstructive sleep apnea. So one has to identify what is actually causing the sleep disturbance. For example, somebody watches a crime movie in the night, late night, or reads a crime thriller in the late night, or makes a conversation, phone call with a friend about some violent thing which happened, obviously it will take time for that person to fall asleep. Getting up early morning because of biological nature calls, biological needs and all those things. So sleep hygiene, it's like a discipline. Suppose if somebody has finished dinner early, 7 or 8 o'clock, and then some watching TV, light reading, listening to some sort of soothing music, all these things can be done, say 10, 11, and then after that, no bright lights, no lying down and then watching TV. Everything has to be switched off. Room has to be dark. No conversation, no phone calls. And has to lie down in a comfortable position. And then within a matter of minutes to half an hour, 1 hour, they'll go into the sleep. Sleep has got stages, light sleep and moderate, and then deep sleep where REM, rapid eye movement sleep, it's known as REM sleep. All those things will happen, and then automatically morning person will wake up energetically. And also all things, for example, students study from whatever they studied from morning to night, whatever they studied, all things will happen. The encoding of the information happens in the night during sleep. The hippocampus encodes, analyzes, encodes, finds which is important, which is not important, which is repeated multiple times. The way hippocampus finds importance is by knowing, suppose if somebody tried to remember cell phone number, a friend's cell phone number 10 times repeatedly, then hippocampus recollects that this is an important number, so a person is trying to recollect 10 times, so it will store it. Suppose if only once or twice casually person looks at one number, then hippocampus will just ignore it, thinking that it's not very important. So all that memory and learning happens actually during sleep. So sleep is very dynamic. Sleep is not waste of time. So I know many students who study whole night before the exams. They don't sleep and then just go to exam directly. That is all stored, whatever information they have, it's all stored in the forebrain as a short-term memory. After 2-3 days, they'll forget. It's a short-term memory, temporary memory in the forebrain, in the front frontal lobe. If you want to remember something for life, only it happens, memory encoding happens only during sleep. So sleep hygiene is like a sleep architecture is like you have a building foundation, you have a building, you have a first floor, second floor, penthouse and all those things. In penthouse, all the dreams happen during sleep. So all the sleep structure has to be built only in an organized and a disciplined way. That is one. Second thing is regarding the diet. All religions follow fasting and then caloric restrictions. And regarding certain specific substances like polyphenols, there is abundant research data from animal experiments. For example, animals which were fed these fruits, they had neurogenesis. These animals, these are all biological experiments after ethics, ethical clearances. So these animals, when they were fed with these polyphenols and later sacrificed as a part of the research protocol and studied, and when the animals' brains were studied, abundant neurogenesis was found following certain interventions like exercise and diet and all those things. So this is all evidence-based, and all of you are free to search Google and other literature. And of course, Fish means it's not just entire fish, there are specific fish. Fruits means not all fruits, some specific fruits have got specific benefits. And of course, one need not import from Amazon everything. You can use locally available things, whatever possible, within the framework, what is good for you. But in general, it is better to cut down carbohydrate and fats at least 1/3. And then you test your memory, how sharp it works with caloric restriction and intermittent fasting. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. That was, so this is very relevant question, I think, sir. Most of the professionals or the students are working in the late nights for completing their works. And even in the COVID time also, we are all in the front of our devices, actually. So one more question, actually. So can we conclude that a human being is a worst animal because we are training from our brain needs years and years to be mature, and we are understanding all time together, and even we are believing our own views and learning coming to the brain. And what is the role of brain in this type of thinking? That means we are believing all the things coming to our brain and not throw away the stupid beliefs. I like that a question.
It's opposite to the one of the earlier questions. Earlier questions is that we have spirituality, and last question is that worst animal. These are actually contradictory views. Someone commented that our brains are not happy with us nowadays because brains are evolved, matured and evolved to do much better things in life, like earlier question mentioned about spirituality. But because of multiple factors, personal, familial, work-related, community-related, social-related, technology-influenced factors, for example, diet, all these factors are not allowing us to achieve the ultimate goal of life, achieving spirituality. I can give several examples. Some of them are controversial. There are one example I'll quote from Brazil. There are mothers as well as unemployed women in Brazil. So they were approached with the job opportunities that they can food outlets, for example, fast food outlets, and then provide food to the people and make a living out of it. So fast food chains established very quickly in Brazil, and women felt empowered. They were doing business. They were offering food to people and then making a living out of it. Very ethical and very empowering thing. But then, the years later, the end result of all these fast food joints is more people got heart attacks and more people got strokes, more people got dementia, more people got Alzheimer's. And so one group of people are inventing and influencing things for their benefits and exploiting others and creating designer diseases, intentionally causing heart attacks and strokes so that they can sell more stents, they can sell more drugs, intentionally planned interventions. These are all planned interventions. There are several things like this. You all know about the vaccine wars happening in the world due to this COVID pandemic. Every country is trying to stockpile essential drugs, vaccines, and drugs for COVID, and then use its power with other nations. Anyway, I do not want to digress to from health to other social issues, but human brains are not going towards worse experiences. There are some unpleasant, unfortunate experiences are happening. Someone commented that one bad apple will not make all the apples bad. And in a school, in an office, in a factory, out of 100 students or out of 100 workers, if 2-3 people make noise, it's naturally, one can say that this class is noisy, this factory is unruly, this office is not good and all those things. But please note that majority of the people, majority of the students, majority of the workers, majority of the people in the office are well disciplined and with good intentions. It's only the minority. And minority are because of multiple other factors. In fact, there's an obligation on the part of all the good people in the world to help and take care of the bad people. Bad are minority, good are majority. I think we should not go more into societal issues from the medical points. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So I think, sir, two more questions we can take. Sir, how one person's brain influences another one, and how hypnotism works?
In maintaining one's own health is not dependent on one's own might, which I mentioned in my talk also. See, when a child is born, child is dependent on mother and father, and later on teachers, later on the families and extended families, and then community and society. So naturally, we are under the influence of our parents and teachers and all the people, in fact, in the society. That's how we learn. That's how we accumulate experiences in life. And our own decisions are based in turn based on our own lifetime experiences. So one influencing other is a natural phenomenon in life. Water flows according to its level, from high level to low level. So person who knows will teach person who do not know. This is a natural thing. So person who want to do something and do not know how to do will go and ask some person, other person, how to do it, and will learn. And unfortunately, in a minority, these things happen in other things also, like drug addiction and antisocial activities also. These things happen. Again, in the greater good, these things have to be, the moment parents see that child, student is under the bad influence of other students, should be able to protect the child, should be able to, one employee is in bad, with bad intentions, other colleagues should be able to try to help him instead of harm him, instead of punish him, instead of penalizing him, should be able to identify and then counsel and then offer help if required. But many things which I'm telling, they're good to talk, but very difficult to implement. It needs an effort, a societal effort. It needs a long-term effort. It needs a intense effort. It needs a lifetime effort of people. World is moving because of goodness of many such people who are working. I'm sorry, can you please repeat your second question? One is helping the other.
Yeah.
One influencing the other.
Yeah.
The second part.
How hypnotism works.
Hypnotism. Actually, I have no expertise in hypnotism, but one simple thing is, brain is very curious. Brain always wants to learn, always wants to experience, always wants to learn new things. If you keep on eating same thing, for example, whatever is your delicacy or your favorite food. Suppose you are fond of eating banana. You first take first banana, it looks very tasty, delicious. Second banana won't be like that. Third banana will not be like that. After few more bananas, you don't feel like eating banana. Same thing about experience also. So in hypnotism, a similar experience is given to a person repeatedly. So the person, the brain, will not be active, will not be looking forward to learn, will not be pursuing new things. So the person will not be carefully observing, curiously looking and responding and all those things, and will become subjective to the effect of the other person. But there are, I'm sure, people with expertise in hypnotism will be able to provide better answers. And please share the email of the person who asked about spirituality and hypnotism. And I'll be happy to go through some scientific studies and will be happy to share in due course. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So one final question more we can take. In this worst COVID time, so we are doing some people are doing quarantine for almost a month. And if loneliness can have adverse effect of brain, and what are the things we can do to make the brain so active rather than calling friends and family? Any other suggestions?
Yeah, I gave one example all the questions you people are asking. I'm not seeing anybody. There is a computer screen in front of me. I feel terribly lonely speaking to the computer screen. That is one way. The other way is that I am interacting with people far and wide who are not just in Bangalore. They're in Kerala. They're in different states of India. They're even in UK, in US, and maybe I was told that 10 different countries. So I am connected to all of them, and I am interacting with all of them. See, this is such an enriching experience for me. So I'm feeling really good that I am having this experience. See, at one way I can feel terribly lonely looking at the computer screen. Other way, I can feel so enriched that this is one of the best experiences in my life. I think people at home, confined to home, should not feel that they are inside the four walls. Only interaction with the external world is getting some food and medicines, and then looking at the TV for some news and information, and they are isolated. And they have no way connected to the rest of the world. Probably if one moves their perspective from that point, it looks different. I don't know if I can share one slide which I didn't show. I think there is no way I can share my share screen. Can I just share one last screen?
Yes, sir. Please. Yeah.
Yeah. You imagine your question is people in home getting lonely and feeling isolated. That is a perspective. They can continue to feel like that. They are always isolated at home and this one. Or they can actually staying inside the house. They can actually get involved in many things which are happening in the world. See, COVID has come now. COVID will go. We shall pass through this COVID experience. And in future, other things may come. Maybe bigger problems, worse problems. Our life may be heaven in future. We don't know. All things are possible. It's a perspective. You look at this picture on the screen. This is a perspective. All of you have a look and tell me, what do you see in this? So this is you're lonely because of COVID. Life is reflected in this picture, this perspective. Is it looking, what do you see in this picture? I don't know. I cannot communicate with participants. Anyway, I'll give a clue. You look at this picture. So there is a beautiful young lady. You see, this is the nose, this is the eyelids, these are cheeks, this is the chin, it's the forehead, this is colorful hair and dress. I hope all of you are able to get that perspective of this young, beautiful lady. Sir, can you agree with me?
Yes, yeah. People are chatting also. Sir.
Now you change your perspective. Okay. Don't look this as eye. Don't look this as nose. Okay. Right. Now, this is not chin. You see this as eye. Not this one. This as eye. This as nose. You see, I'm pointing towards the nose. Okay, this is the nose, this is the eye, this is the mouth, and this is the neck. This is an old lady. You see, you look here, young lady, that way. That's one perspective. You look this side, this eye, this is the nose, this is mouth, this is neck.
Yes, right. Yeah.
This is old lady. Is it old lady or is it young lady?
Yeah, now the dimension is changed, sir, actually.
Yeah, it's a perspective. So loneliness is a perspective. Loneliness is a perceived thing. You can get connected to anything. You can get connected to music. You can get connected to literature. You can connect it to fine arts. You can get connected to finance. You can get connected to people. You can get connected to world. You can get connected to not only just you take world as your family. You take all your lifetime experiences and then you share, you talk to people. Don't have to talk to you only your family member, immediate family member always. You can talk to many people. You can talk to friends, extended family, extended friends. You can write blogs. You can use social media. You can do so many things. It's no doubt, COVID is a very stressful experience. We, in medical school, we read about so many diseases. We read about the Spanish flu, much worse than COVID, happened 100 years ago. We read only in books. It didn't affect us much. But now we are actually living through the pandemic. This is not reading. We're not getting news through TV and newspapers. We are really getting, we are living through the, it's like living through the fire, living through the, going through the forest and all those things. So I don't know how long we'll go through this experience, but my belief as well as experience, as well as impression of people conveyed to through media is that we'll pass through this. It's a matter of time. It may be months. It may even last for a year or two also. We don't know. But we'll pass through it. Most of the people, 98, 99% of people, will not get affected. Even if they are COVID positive, they'll recover uneventfully. Only a minority of people will get affected. Weekend, I was attending a webinar by Minister of Health on integrated medicine, and one of the panelists commented that through their networks, that hundreds and thousands of people all over the world who are practicing meditation, none of them had COVID illness. This data is being collected only when it is published, we can quote. But this is what I heard, which I conveyed to you. So at home, isolation, loneliness, beat it by doing all things I mentioned and more things which will make you happy and joyful. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. And as all the feedbacks from the participants are saying, this was a great and enriching and excellent session, sir. Yeah, we are so happy to see that, sir. So now it's time to conclude all these things, sir. So let me invite Dr. Krishna Uma, who is the president of Project Management of Institute Kerala, for delivering the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir. Krishna Uma, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Harindralal, and thank you, sir. Hi, all. Good evening. What a wonderful session, sir. Brain health. The brain is one of the most largest and the most complex organs in the human body. That is what people say, and it is made up of 100 billion nerves. That's you were telling about that. I think we got more information that during the very short time, and the brain is getting exploding. So. Considering the time, I would like to move to my duty. Dr. Bhaskar Rao, sir, professor, head of the department.
I just want to clarify. I completed my headship recently. Now I am, you can say, former head, or I am a head of a unit. So I just want to clarify.
Yes, sir. Professor and former head, neurosurgery department, unit 1, in IMHANS. I would like to place on record our sincere thanks for taking this wonderful session. It was so insightful, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Very kind of you. I hope it's useful to you.
Yeah. Everybody is telling great, great things about your session, and it was so wonderful. And the last thing with the perspective was something very super. Sir.
Thank you.
And I would like to place some. The gratitude on record, that is Sumodh Sundar from CSI, A.G. Harindralal from IEEE, Sudhir from VMFT for coordinating this session so wonderfully well. And finally, to all of you who have joined from all parts of the world for gathering knowledge and that too about the complex organ in our body, the brain.
If I can just make one comment,
yes, sir.
I spent the best part of my life in Kerala.
Okay.
I worked at Sri Chitra Tirunal Institute for 10 years. And during my tenure, my wife, Sunita, actually she worked for the VMFT.
Wow.
So it's a small tribute from our side to Sri Chitra and VMFT. And now my daughter is studying at Amrita Institute of Medical Science at Kochi. So it's a small tribute to our lifelong association and relationship with state of Kerala. And thank you very much for that.
Thank you so much, sir, for the kind words. And thank you all for patiently listening to this wonderful session and asking so much of excellent questions. And sir, we are getting a lot of feedback from all the participants regarding your excellent session, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. So, yeah. Over to you, sir, Harindralal, sir. Sir, Harindralal, sir.
Yeah, on behalf of the organizations, once again, I express our gratitude for your excellent session. And so many people could not attend the session, and it's also our great difficulties. Thank you very much. See you next time.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, once again, thank you, sir, and thank you, dear participants. Yeah, thank you. Have
shall,
a good day.
Shall we send the questions to you?
Yeah, sure, sir. I'll be delighted to go through and then answer all of them through email to the best of my ability. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for the opportunity.
All of the participants who has posed questions are requested to send their email ID also.
Yes,
so that we can, that can be sent.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Yeah.